Welcome back. The term white privilege is a phrase you've probably been hearing a lot more of over the last month as part of discussions about racial inequality after the death of George Floyd sparked a worldwide movement. So we decided to bring in Karlyn, Percil and Dr. Karyn Gordon to start a conversation on this topic. And I say start because this is a huge topic and we need a lot of conversation, more than one segment on TV can allow. Ladies, thank you so much for joining us. We're talking about white privilege. So let's just start with a basic definition. White privilege, simplified, refers to the concept that people have basic rights and benefits simply because they are white. It does not mean they haven't suffered. It doesn't mean they don't have hardship in life. It's nothing about that. It just means that the color of their skin isn't the thing that has made their life hard. It means having the luxury of being able to step outside without fearing that you're going to be discriminated against or oppressed in any way because of the color of your skin. It is highly controversial, white privilege, this concept. So Karyn, talk to me a little bit about why it's so controversial and how you would define white privilege.
You had asked me, Tracy, a month ago if I would have considered myself white privilege. I would have said no, because I did not understand what it was. You know, I did not come from a privileged, economically privileged family. So that's how I interpret it. And I think that's maybe where a lot of white folks get stuck on this. And I never really thought about how my being white actually would have really helped me. And I think that's why education is everything. We have to really understand what it is, because if we don't understand it, we immediately get defensive, not thinking that I'm going to be kind of criticized about the color of my skin. There are these subtle privileges. As a white female, I have experienced, and I have never thought about it before.
Karlyn, you break down white privilege. How do you break it down?
Yes, and Karyn, thank you for addressing the elephant in the room, in the sense of you see that you belong, and everywhere you go, you see yourself on television, so you're affirmed with every single step you take in life. And I take white privilege and I deconstruct it further, and I say, you know, look at also position privilege, because when you look at senior leadership in most industries, we don't see ourselves represented at all, right? We don't see that belonging, that confirmation. There's also pay privilege as well within the white privilege context. Historically, we know that we still have a huge pay equity gap. Black women, Latino women, women of color are paid less. And there's also power privilege, language, words. When someone who is white says something, it is usually taken within the context of, oh, yes, this is right. This is brilliant. And usually when it's coming from, you know, a black or a person of color, there's a little bit of debate or checking for credentials.
Karlyn, I love that you did this. You shared on social media that for years, many white people haven't faced their emotional commitment to racism and the role they play in upholding overt and covert racist behavior in the workplace and the world at large. And the reason why I want to talk about this is because, yes, racism is police brutality, but racism also comes out in the workplace in other forms, like microaggressions or gaslighting or sabotage or having your voice minimized. And you call this white SPF. Can you tell us a little about this and how people can begin to dismantle this and start making some change?
White SPF stands for white superiority, white privilege, and white fragility. Because on the journey of confronting white privilege or having that discussion, there will be white fragility. There'll be a lot of defensiveness, a lot of, oh, but I worked hard for everything that I have. And the key about addressing this is that it gives us an opportunity to actually start looking at what are some of the systemic barriers that are actually getting in the way in terms of ensuring that equity is actually extended to all. And when you look at the definition of equity, equity looks at what are some of the advantages that was given based on skin privilege, and what are some of the barriers that, because we don't have that skin privilege, that we have been subjected to for so many centuries. So starting looking at, you know, white SPF, to me, is the beginning of the journey to emotionalize what it means to, in terms of what we have struggled through when it comes to anti-Black racism or anti-racism.
Okay, I like the emotional element, because it's nice to hear reassurance that your feelings actually count, because when you're a box and a check mark, or it's a stat, it's a thing, but when it's a feeling and an anecdote, it's actually also important and it does hold weight. So bringing the emotion back in is important. Now, Karyn, you said something interesting in one of your posts. You said one of the reasons why you never went down this line of thought is because you wanted to stay in your own lane. And I know there are so many other white folks out there that think to themselves, I don't want to say the wrong thing. I don't know if my voice should even be added to this debate because I'm not a black person. So what is the learning that went through, that you went through to understand your voice is actually needed because your privilege can help us?
The first thing that was a bit of my awakening is realizing, and I posted this on Instagram as well, is for a lot of us, and I even did a little stat, 88% of the people that were on my Instagram, they basically acknowledged they kind of see racism as individual, right? So it's an individual, it's a conscious choice about actually harming somebody else. That's kind of what we kind of learned with what we were educated about, realizing that for a long time, I kind of thought that I'm not going to get involved in their problem, right? This is their problem. I'm going to stay in my own lane. And it wasn't until I started unpacking that, I'm like, oh my goodness, I had this massive aha moment. Like, this is not their problem to fix. Our ancestors, our white ancestors, are the ones that created this. Therefore, I have a massive role in really raising my voice and taking a lead in this.
Karlyn, you're amazing when it comes to the topic of vulnerability, and you've spoken so much about it. So how do non-Blacks equip themselves to jump into a space like this and to have these uncomfortable conversations and ask themselves these uncomfortable questions?
So the first step is being comfortable saying words like white privilege, racism, am I racist? Like get comfortable with those words, because until we, you know, address the elephant in the room, it will continue to be a little bit of skirting around the issue and put it back on us when we have just been trying to survive for so long. Leap from performative allyship into inclusive, accountable allyship.
Karlyn and Karyn, thank you so much for this introduction into a subject that we could literally talk about for a whole show. Maybe even a whole series. Thank you so much for your openness and your willingness to help educate and teach and also put yourself out there as an example of someone who is learning. We love to see it.